Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. Okay, well, folks, as you can see, the primary is sort of behind us, and now we get into the elections and the issues. As you know, as a result of the primary aspect of it, there are many, it's like anything else, there are a number of folks who ran for office during that particular period of time, and so naturally, each of them brought their own issues to the table. But now we've sort of got, because issues will be discussed pretty well with among two people, if not that, some will not be discussed. And what I mean by that, those individuals who are not going to be challenged in the general election. But here on the Oregon Voters Digest, we're going to talk about those issues as far as those individuals who did not have any challenges in the general election. Okay, so joining me at this point in time is Fred Stewart. You've seen Fred before. He indicated to me that he's out selling real estate today, so unfortunately he doesn't have the attire that he normally wears, but that's kind of like, that's the way one has to deal when out there out there trying to sell in the property. But anyway, why don't we just get right up into this situation? We're going to just get some feedback from Fred in terms of, one, what he thought about the election, and then we'll just kind of go from there. Fred, welcome aboard.
Thank you, Bruce. Okay. I'm sorry I don't have my suit on, Marine. I appreciate you pointing out to me how important it is to wear the uniform of the day.
But you're selling. But you're selling.
But I'm working.
You're out in the farms, right? You're out in the sticks right now.
Now I'm out in the sticks, having a very good time helping people become move into
going in basements and all kinds of stuff. Sounds good. So let's get right into this piece here. And what do you think? What races were you interested in during that particular time?
I was interested, of course, like I said before, in the Multnomah County race that you were involved in, Loretta Smith.
Right.
I was interested in, of course, the Nick Fish race.
Right.
I was interested in on the Republican side, the Monica Welby race.
How about Salzman? Were you interested in that race at all?
No.
It was kind of like a...
No, I wasn't interested. I mean, I figured Dan was going to win, you know.
Well, let's talk about Fish for a minute. I mean, the Sharon Maxwell, as far as I'm concerned, is a very bright person. And there were a couple other people. And there was Michael Duro. He also ran.
Yep, Sharon was very refreshing. It really hurts my feelings personally that the Oregonian didn't give her more of an opportunity to get to know her. I mean, those white people down there, they just don't know how much they are feeding into the racial divide here in Portland. Well, maybe they do know, and they don't give a darn. Who cares? Mm-hmm. But you know, she was a person that I wish the Oregonian, other people in the media, other white people in media, because black media sucks. They don't have any readership. But white media, I really wish white media had paid closer attention to her and given her an opportunity. Even if at the end of the day they would have, you know, found her to be not as viable. But you never know. To me, that was a pleasant surprise. To me, she was a viable candidate, and she had a lot of very good ideas and good things to say. And it's very disappointing that they didn't pay attention to her.
You know, one of the things I was thinking about as you think about her, and she's very, as far as I'm concerned, very bright, and hopefully she'll stick around and run again this next time around for some office, for that matter. But the fact of the matter, this water thing that came up, you know, the whole idea with the water, you know, with the bond measure for the water and aspect of it, I thought it was kind of interesting that it came up during that particular time. And then that was one thing. The other thing is the fact that we also all had to, the E. coli thing that just jumped up all of a sudden. What would have happened had that occurred prior to the...
I don't think much would have changed, because I think when most people in Portland decided that they did not want another layer of government, they didn't trust the layer that was being presented to them. I mean, these guys lost me when they committed to the seven elected commissioners who were going to invest 160 hours a month of their time to be commissioners, yet not get paid for it. And I just can't imagine anybody... I'm concerned about anybody who can vote that much time to government service and not get paid for it.
Well, Mayor Hales gave him that piece, right? That's for the Water Bureau. Remember that?
Yeah.
And I think who was that? Who had it before?
Randy Leonard had it before. But Randy wanted it.
Randy wanted it.
And from what I've been told, nobody on city council wanted it, including Nick Fish, mm-hmm. but he had no choice. Mm-hmm. The mayor is the one that decides.
But had he not had that particular piece, do you think that would have had some impact on the race with reference to two people that ran against him?
Not really. Mm-hmm. Not really. I mean, because people overwhelmingly support the city keeping the Water Bureau. So having the Water Bureau, I think in the long run, is going to look at it that it wasn't a negative for Nick Fish. Mm-hmm. People thought it was. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm a guy that supports a PUD. If it was up to me, all of our utilities would be managed by a credible PUD, not just the Water Bureau, but the gas company, electric company, because I think the people of Portland, the people of the Portland market are being ripped off. But that said, this PUD effort, this last Water Bureau effort, it was just a poor plan. Beyond the title, it just didn't hold water. And I think most people in Portland noticed that, picked that up on it, and voted against it. I voted against it.
You mentioned about the black community in regards to this particular issue here. Now, I noticed that some of the black leaders, I think Margaret Carter and I think Avell and I think Loretta and Roy J had supported Nick Fish. And that what happened with reference to the support of Sharon?
Well, you know, Bruce, this is something like I Brudy's talked about and other people have talked about. Mm-hmm. We are at a crisis when it comes to black leadership. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's an insult anytime anybody white brings up Margaret Carter as somebody that should be supported. Margaret, about 90% of the black women I know in Oregon, Margaret Carter can't hold their underwear. You know, I mean, she is not a person that's ever contributed to Northeast Portland or to the black community at the level that white people hold her up to. And I'm just flat, and you know, it's to me, it's a flat insult. Like I've said before, it's just wrong. Roy J, you know, who knows why Roy J supported Nick? Maybe they're old buddies. I don't know. It's not like Roy J's running around asking me and other people in the community, how's your relationship with Nick? Is Nick helping the community? Same thing with Avell and the other black people that support it. It's not like they're running around asking people in the black community, how is this person performing? You know, I think what these black people are pretty much telling everybody, I'm getting what I want, mm-hmm. and I'm happy with it. Mm-hmm. So let me support this white person. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know?
So is it over with now? I mean, you think there's going to be some questions about Fish? Because he got over 51% of the vote.
Oh, it's over with until the next election if he runs again.
So we shouldn't have any discussion in the general election about that particular issue?
No.
At all?
No.
Whatsoever?
No. We got other issues to worry about. Other things, other contested things to deal with. You know, we got a governor's race. We got a Senate race. We got a few other issues ahead that I think we all should pay closer attention to. Hopefully more people will pay attention to it and will vote this next time out than what we just went through.
Mm-hmm. Well, position two, as you know, where I ran in that particular piece aspect mm-hmm. of it, I too was very interested in some of the other issues that should have been brought to the table. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The voc ed, if you will, the mm-hmm. Portland public schools, the vet situation, the small business aspect of it, and whatever. And unfortunately, the media did not focus on those things at all, you know, even from the standpoint that they didn't even recognize the fact that I was a vet, or even a Marine, or even a small business person, or even a senior citizen.
Well, you got to remember, most of the people who are, you know, are managing editors and stuff like that of our media,
they've never been in the military.
They didn't join the military. Quite a few of them, half of them probably were hippies, were anti-military. Yeah. So you're not going to get any love from a lot of people in the middle, especially when you walk into Oregonian. Mm-hmm. Black guy, wow, one strike. Mm-hmm. A veteran, been in Vietnam, may have killed somebody. Oh yeah, Bruce. You know, you really know how to not make friends with people at the Oregonian. Jeez. Or the Tribune.
Yeah, but the vet thing has been just recently late about the healthcare vets and all that. It was been out there. It's been on the table.
Bruce, these guys don't even talk about white people that are vets.
What about senior citizens?
You know, the senior citizen issue isn't in the forefront of Portland politics right now. Yeah. Unless, you know, I ain't saying it shouldn't be. I was very proud of you for bringing up these issues. And I can tell from the amount of votes that you got, there were people that were listening. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I encourage you and others to keep doing what you did, because that's the only way we're ever going to, you know, get change. We can't be afraid.
Well, my issue was to try to bring some other folks in. There were a couple of other folks that were running also, too. Mm-hmm. There was Teresa Rayford, and then there was the other guy.
No, Jeremiah Johnson.
Not Jeremiah.
Kelvin?
Kelvin Hall. Kelvin Hall ran.
Yeah, Jeremiah ran for the Metro.
I thought
that
was very
Metro.
I had the opportunity to actually sit in the interviews, if you will, because I was running also, too. And like you were saying, I mean, these folks were very, I mean, they would not even, they weren't even listening to what the what they were talking to. I think Kelvin brought some issues up, some major issues aspect of it. But yeah. it was very interesting. When I think about the Oregonian again, I remember the Stickles, you know, when the Stickles were at the Oregonian, I remember vets were being recognized. Because I remember when I was doing the...
Well, Fred Stickles, a Marine.
Yeah, that's right. And, yeah. his son was, too.
Yep, his son was a Marine.
And so now they're not there anymore. So all of a sudden, the Globe and Ankle is not around anymore.
Okay? Well, you know, it's just sign of the times.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
But look, Bruce, don't even ignore this. You lost these guys when they notice you're a black guy. I mean, if you notice how they treat most black politicians, I mean, the only reason they were treating Loretta the way they did is because of Ron Wyden.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, they're not going to piss off Ron Wyden.
No.
Not over this.
No.
You know, this is his black person. Yeah. We are not going to disrespect her. Mm-hmm. You know, but, you know, they've lost, again, an incredible opportunity. I mean, the paper's looking for readers. They're looking to become more viable in this market. Gee whiz. You know, they just missed a very good historic opportunity, mm-hmm. you know. Hopefully they don't miss it again the next time around if it happens around.
Well, you know, I give her all the kudos, if you will, there is, but hopefully that she'll recognize some of the issues that we were discussing while we were running during the primary.
We'll see. I mean, Loretta, it's not like Loretta is, you know, Satan or anything like that. She's, you know, she's a good person.
Yeah,
every one of you guys, like I said before, good people.
But
very
it was
happy
about
you're
the
around.
Issues. It was about the issues.
It was about the issues.
It was about the education piece of it. I mean, Portland Public School has the highest failure rates among blacks in the state of Oregon. Okay.
One of the highest in the country.
In the country, for that matter.
Yeah, I think Iowa and Nebraska both have higher graduation rates for black people than Oregon does.
There's no voc ed, if you will, there. Outlining area, there's voc ed aspect of it.
But you see, this is why I thought...
Mental illness is big, it's huge.
That's why I thought your race was a great opportunity, because there's a lot of things in the black community that's stagnant.
Yes.
And a lot of things that haven't gotten better over the last 40 years.
Right.
And they had four black people, articulate black people, running against each other.
Yeah.
I thought the media had a great opportunity to see if any of these people have an inclination or a clue on how to finally solve a lot of issues, mm-hmm. you know, within the black community.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Either by example or by process. I mean, I was waiting for the Oregonian or somebody to call out Loretta on her jobs program, her you know, her minimum wage job program, which, you know, doesn't do nothing, hasn't done nothing for the black community. But, you know, there was a great opportunity there. How many businesses have been created? You know, ask all four of you, what would you do with the county to convince the city to include more minorities, black people, in the urban renewal development zones? What would they do? What would they do to lobby, local business owners?
Well, like Trader
Joe's, hire
the
more
Trader
black
Joe
people.
Issues could have been a good issue to
Trader
be
Joe's
to
issue would have been a good one. Would have been a very good one.
Very good to have that discussion.
Yes,
on
it would have been.
Line. Because we got the negative hit as far as black people are concerned that we did not want it.
No, some.
You see what I'm saying?
Some black
people.
Yeah, but
people.
Some.
But
and once
saying,
again, because the media let it happen.
That's what I'm saying.
I mean,
from
gee
the
whiz.
Media standpoint. Yeah.
I mean, these guys won't talk to Sharon Maxwell, you, or other black candidates, but gee whiz, they'll sit down with Serena Boston Ashby, who lives out in Tiger, never went to doesn't live in Portland, and ask her what a house four blocks from my house, I mean, what a property four blocks from my house, what should be done with it? I mean, sometimes white people can be crazy. can just be crazy.
Well, but like I said, I think that the issue should be on the table, you know, hopefully Loretta recognizes that, and it's not a personal thing. Is that there's some major issues there? In that
no, I think Loretta. I mean, she may surprise me, but she should look at it that way.
Yeah.
She should look at it that way.
So it was a good campaign. As far as I'm concerned, it was good that we had the discussion. And I guess the other area that I thought was interesting in regards to this race, you know, they finally recognized the fact that I'm a talk show host. Oregon Voters Digest aspect as a result of the interviews we had with Baruti. I thought they were very fruitful, if you will. What are your thoughts about that?
I thought they were very fruitful, too. I have no doubt 10, 15 years from now, there's going to be some professor down at PSU or some other black studies here in the Northwest is going to go and look at those interviews and dissect them and break them down. And, I mean, some of them were, you know, was emotional. Some of them were, you know, a man that was just hurt and just sharing, you know, just venting.
Yeah, right.
Clearly. But he let out a lot of good local, recent Black history. He gave a view that most white people don't think about, even the ones that care about us, and Black people have inclinations about, but never have had, this media doesn't get into it.
Right.
There's no way for them to really, you know, verify. I think what Broody did on his three shows is an incredible gift to the Black community. Yeah. And I know he's going to be punished for it, but I know, I hope Broody understands what he's done is one of the most important things done to the Black community in a political sense.
And especially young people coming now.
Yeah.
Coming up to the... They'll have a chance.
Well, a lot of young Black people coming up don't understand a couple of things. One, they've got to be committed to their community as a whole.
Right.
Two, they've got to be cognizant and committed to improving the Black community
right.
through their efforts.
Right.
But this is a community thing. They've got to be part of the solution of bringing the community together, not splitting the community apart. And they've got to hold each other accountable. And they don't have any examples for that. I mean, Margaret Carter, yeah, right. You know what I mean? Name a Black leader in the last 30 years. I can't think of any. So that's what was good for what Broody did. We got a lot of great Black business people, young people coming on board that are just really focusing. I do feel that we got some future Black political leaders that are coming up. And... you know, I hope that they're looking at what's going on today and are embracing it and learning from it so that they can be better, because that's what I expect from all of them, to be better than all of us and definitely be better than the people who are inflicted on us as leadership. You know, people who have, like I said the other day, they've never W-2'd anybody, that's created a job. They're not a leader in any academic area, you know, as far as science or anything like that. And they're not a leader in our trades, you know, but simply because they're Black and, you know, they don't piss off, you know, the white folks that they're Oregonian too much, they're considered leaders. Mm-hmm.
So you think they might be listening?
I do feel.
The white folks?
I think the younger ones. Mm-hmm. I think people my age and older, I don't think they're listening too much. I think a lot of white people feel they've done enough. You know, they don't feel like doing any more. You know, we got a Black president.
Yeah,
but I do feel the younger generation, they're looking at things a little differently.
Don't you feel, though, that i.e. with a Black president and President Obama had an impact, if you will, on all the races?
It's had an incredible impact. I mean, you can just see it on TV, see more Black people on TV. You know, it's great that we have a Black president, but we still got a lot of issues. Most of our issues that I feel, that I care about, are the ones local. We still got a lot of local... we've got a lot to do with this local racial divide,
mm-hmm.
and this local racial divide, I won't say it's bigger than it's been in 30 years, but it hasn't shrunk as much as people think.
Mm-hmm. When I think about you know, the whole issue of history, you know, because you almost have to have that tool, if you will, in mm-hmm. order to relate, especially in a country like this, and Black culture has not been taught in schools. You know what I mean? For both sides, for that matter.
Well, you know, the thing is, in Portland, I always hear this, Bruce. What is Black culture in Portland?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really? I mean, the most successful Black people I know, their lives are no different to a great degree than the most successful white people I know.
Mm-hmm. I'm talking about it as far as participation, you know, from the standpoint of this country, you know, like in the 1800s, during Lincoln, as you know, that's why I identify myself as a Lincoln Republican, to try to bring that history to the table.
You
see what I'm saying?
Correct, I agree.
And I think that's a very important piece. It's my understanding from former Governor Kulongoski, he and I chatted about this piece about the culture, and they had passed a bill that talked about putting culture into the schools, but they never enforced it.
Correct. Well, yeah, I mean, I've heard about that,
culture
too.
Culture across the board,
yeah.
But culture for everybody.
I've heard about
Russia,
that, too.
The whole nine yards.
But how are you
going to do that?
Well, the thing is, how do you enforce that? I mean, how do you get, you know, some racist white school administrator or teacher in Eastern Oregon
Teach black culture. But Democrats have always touted themselves from the standpoint that they identify with black people and all their issues.
Yeah, I hear that. I hear that, but you know I don't know. I mean, I'm glad symbolically they passed it, but I don't know. I worry about more about Portland. Something like that could be very successful in the Portland market if we had better leadership in our school district.
Well, now, as you know, we're getting right into the general election. We got a gubernatorial race that's going to be a good one. I mean, you got, in all due respect, the present governor is having some problems, you know, with the bridge situation, with the healthcare thing aspect of it. And, you know, so the idea is that here's an opportunity, if you will, to discuss this issue, if you will, because President Obama is not going to be here this next time around.
Really?
What about talking about the issues and concerns?
It would be refreshing if the Republicans would bring this up and talk to our governor about it. But I'm not really going to hold my breath that Richardson is the type of...
But we're going to keep it on the table. Now,
you're going to keep it on the table,
I'm the engagement chair for the state. Are going to keep it on the table.
One of the issues I'm pretty sure Kid Cyber's people are not preparing him for is what would happen to him, what he should do, and how he should react if Richardson starts talking about black people. Richardson is not going to be talking about black people.
Be.
Well, I'm
going to make him talk about
it. Oh, you will?
That's my job.
All right.
That's my
if
job.
You do, if he does it, I will give you credit for it.
Well, I'm going to have you right there, too.
Uh-huh. We'll see.
To talk about the issue and the concerns of this area.
No.
You think so?
It would be nice. It would not offend me if it would happen.
Yes.
You know, but, you know, I wouldn't. I wouldn't be offended if, geez, Jennifer Hudson gave me a hug either. But Jennifer Hudson.
What about Monica? You think she might be able to talk to this issue? With reference to,
you know, I think any white politician can talk about it, Republican or Democrat. I just would be surprised if she did. I mean, I wouldn't be offended. You know,
Merkley's going to talk about it.
No, he's not going to talk about it.
About black people?
No, he doesn't.
You don't think so?
No, he doesn't.
Hmm.
He doesn't feel he has to.
Wow.
Because every black person in his district, in the state for that matter, could vote against him, and he could still win by like 92 points. No, he's not. Merck is a nice guy. I've known Jeff, and I think he's been a great senator. But Jeff's not gonna talk, and you know he's not gonna talk about black stuff too much, since one of his people he really enjoys the support of is Margaret Carter. You know, because the first thing he's worried about that somebody is gonna ask him, Jeff, what has Margaret Carter done other than singing Negro spirituals? Is there a law? Is there an act? Has anything changed since 1984 because she exists? You know what I mean? Had Margaret Carter never gone into politics, is there anything in the black community? Is there any relationships
in
that
district?
No. Jeff's a good man. We got a lot of good white people in this state that will just not deal with black issues. That's why I live in constant frustration.
But what if Monica makes it an issue?
It would be a pleasant surprise. It would be a pleasant surprise. I'm not expecting it to happen, but Bruce, if it happens,
I'm going to be lobbying her. That's my job.
I'm not going to be offended.
Is that right? I'm going to be lobbying her very much to identify. She was on the show, as you know.
Yep,
she
yep.
came here.
She came here.
I mean, that was a first, if you will.
Naturally, Bruce, we got a lot of nice white people in politics.
I've invited Jeff, but he's not come on. Get him on. You think we can get him on?
I'll ask him. I doubt he'll come on, but I'll ask him. You know, Jeff's a good guy. Jeff would be a good interview.
Yeah, he would be a good interview.
He would. And I'm looking forward to the debates between the two of them. I mean, Jeff's a smart guy. Monica Wellby's a smart woman. This is, on a lot of levels, it's a good race.
But why not have a debate on race? Why not?
They're not going to do it. White people don't do that, Bruce. They don't feel comfortable.
Why not?
They don't feel comfortable.
But they're constantly talking about the whole issue.
They only talk about it when black people raise it up or when we're in the room. If we're not in the room, they're not talking about it. Most of the rooms that Jeff Merkley goes in, regardless of how the policy is going to affect black people, I guarantee, do not come up. It only comes up when we talk about it.
He's probably been in the presence of President Obama.
The
issue there?
All right, when president's in the room, and I'm sure occasionally the president's, maybe black issues comes up, but the president leaves the room. And there are times, I'm sure, there's nobody black in the room that Jeff's in. And he's not going to talk about black folks if he doesn't have to. Same thing with Monica. That's just how it is. That's what makes what the Oregonian did to Sharon Maxwell and you and other black people so hard.
Yeah.
You know, it, I mean, they, I don't know. Yeah. I can't express how much damage the Oregonian is inflicting on black people.
Well, I agree.
By
I
treating, agree. And well, I'm weak and others,
I agree.
By treating black people like they do in a market like us. Because we got a lot of very, very nice white people that don't think about black people unless a black person says, oh, by the way, what you just did was offensive.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it, and the thing is not that they don't know, they just don't pay attention.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And when it comes to policy issues and public involvement, black community involvement, and how policies affect the black community, exactly. both limiting and otherwise, most of these people, as nice as they are, they're ambivalent.
Yeah, yeah.
They're ambivalent. Yeah. I mean, honestly, these are the Jeff Merkley could accidentally, and I mean, I'm not joking, he could accidentally vote for something that would basically enslave a small percentage or a larger percentage of the black community.
Yeah.
He would regret it, and I'm sure he would fight against it, mm-hmm. but it would slip by him.
It would
slip by him. I mean, he would be against it. I ain't saying he's for slavery,
mm-hmm.
you know, or wants slavery. Mm-hmm. But the attention to detail to how things affect black people,
mm-hmm.
nah, you, mm-hmm. and he's a nice guy. What do you think the mean ones are like? You know, I mean.
Well, I fought with a lot of mean. We have too.
Yeah.
In the court, right?
You correct. Know,
we've had our issues in the court.
Yeah. We've had our issues with the yeah.
We've had our issues aspect of it. And like you said, I make you're right. I make that point about the fact that, you know, as you can see, I'm donning the Vietnam deal, and I'm mm-hmm. about routine, the Marine Corps pin, the U.S. pin. But they don't recognize that as far as black people are concerned in many ways.
Correct. Well, like I said, Bruce.
I think
the younger people are different.
Yeah, right. Oh, yeah. They're
just like my generation is different than the generation before.
Right.
You know, sometimes I do feel to myself that, you know, there's only so far you can push somebody 50 years old.
Yeah.
You know, now it comes down to what changes can be made between a person 40 and 50, and what changes can be made with a person between 20 and 30, and so on. You know, there's only so far you can, you know, people can, you know, can go until they're set in, you know, they're set in their ways.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
we do, you know. But you know, it's good that I think you and others do bring this issue up.
And
I try to bring it up.
Yeah,
bring it up too.
Yeah.
But we, you know, we got to be real. We've got some very, very nice people.
But we got to talk about it. We got to talk about it, right?
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
What lasting thing you want to say to the upcoming electorate in the general election? What do you say to them? What do you say to them about, i.e., getting black folks to the table? Or getting folks across
well,
the board.
Well, it's like what I always tell, ask my white friends. If you care about black people and you care about racial equality, feel free to ask at least one question of your favorite candidate or even your least favorite candidate, all candidates. You know, how is their leadership going to improve racial relations within their market, you know, within their district? There's nothing wrong with that.
And then listening to the answer. Yeah.
And see if that candidate, if they reflect your values,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
And see if that candidate is somebody who can bring people together.
Mm-hmm.
Because this isn't black people against white people or white people against black people.
Right.
This is just bringing people together and being fair.
Exactly.
You know, being fair and
being
allowing
American.
People to have...
Being
Americans. Being
American.
Open opportunity.
And
we need the people we elect to be the people who protect those opportunities and help create those opportunities.
Yeah. Yeah.
But they have to be cognizant they have to do it.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, that's why we're doing this, and that, right from Fred, that's why I appreciate the fact that you're out there. You grew up in this area.
Mm-hmm.
You know a lot of folks, if you will, and I really feel I feel great and comfortable about the fact that you're sharing your thoughts, your opinions, and whatever, in a very open, honest kind of a manner. And I really appreciate that, and I'm sure that the viewing public also appreciates that. So thank you, and thank you for being involved, because you know you're going to be part in the general election. You know that, don't you?
Yeah.
You will be sitting out here at the table. Talking to these folks, right?
Yep.
Is that fair?
Yep. And I appreciate you always keeping me in the loop.
Hey, you will be in the loop because you are the loop. Simplify.
Simplify.
Hey, look, folks, we're going to take a short break and we'll be back with our second guest, okay?
Is it still on us?
Look like we're still there. We are still there. We're going to take this break here very shortly, okay? There we go.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Push the door, I guess.
Oh, yeah, I will.
Well.
Here we go.
Oh, look like we're here. Look like we're here. Gee whiz, I'm sitting there making small talk. Well, now, this is it, folks. Now, this is the guy we're going to be going into the general election. I'm talking about my dear friend Bob Williams. You've seen Bob here many times over. And we've had our on and this and back and forth routine. But let's put it this way. We got both of the major parties sitting here at the table here. Mm. We got a Democrat in Bob, and they got a Republican in Bruce Broussard, a Lincoln Republican.
Okay.
Okay. Maybe we say something very positive about that Klan. That Klan thing has always said something about the Democrats.
Yeah.
And I know you don't associate with that piece of the Democratic Party.
Well,
I know that better.
Some people haven't moved into the 21st
right,
century.
Right. Right.
So
right.
We understand.
And that's why we're having these discussions.
Yeah.
Because I'm having some issues with my own folks at times. Sometimes I understand what the deal is. But I think this is good, and I think that through the years that we've been together, we've thrown issues out on the table that talks to progression, mm-hmm. which is very, very important. And we've talked about the electorate on many occasions, folks running for office and this, that, and the other. And I think we both agree to the fact that we still have to give respect to anybody who filed to want to run for office
right.
on either side of the aisle, or even have served.
Yes.
Plus or minus, the fact of the matter is that is not an easy task. Fair?
100%. you're a better man than me for running. Because people have asked me, they say, you have a little knowledge about politics. Why haven't you run for anything?
Yeah, right.
And I tell them all the time, maybe one day I will. But right now, politics, can get more done outside by being behind the chair than you can being in the chair.
Right.
And so it's one of those things where we have to get some people in that are listening and some people that are not so interested in feathering their own bed for when they leave but worrying about the electorate.
Right. Because a lot of times they use it, and I've learned this through the years, aspect of it, as I run for a purpose, if you will, to talk to you. Because we talk about issues all the time.
Oh, all the
here
time.
At the Oregon Voters Digest. Yeah. And a lot of times we note that a lot of folks who are coming new on this, as you say, it may be a personal thing or this, that, and the other, but a lot of times they don't deal with the issues.
Right.
And so we bring the issues up. And so sometimes, I put my hat in there, but with the understanding that we're trying to focus to the issues, because I bring some of the issues that we're talking about to the table aspect of it. So when they use the word perennial when it comes to me, there's no such animal when it comes to black folks, if you hear what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's a whole different ball game.
It all depends on what day it is as to what flavor you get.
Exactly. So Bob, you've been sitting on the side now for a minute. We're getting ready to go into the general election. Yeah. We're gonna be very shortly. We're gonna be having a presidential race aspect of it, and I know very much we're very much involved with the Clintons, and that's gonna be a heavy piece with Hillary.
It is.
But I know you were there when you was there before.
Right.
When President Obama actually ended up with the deal. So now she's gonna be coming back to the table.
Right.
That's one aspect of it. I'm sure as you heard Fred and whatever, some of the concerns that I had initially was about the voc ed stuff. And things are on that line, and with reference to the community aspect of it, and how do we get the majority to get to the table to address some of those issues?
Well,
what do you think?
One of the things that I've noticed has happened is that people have stopped talking about jobs.
Yeah.
They are now talking about ways of living. Mm-hmm. they stopped talking about housing, and they're trying to find out where can we put them. Mm-hmm. You know, so they just it's the same old story, but it's just different verbiage to describe what's going on. And so we have to get our politicians to begin to say, how is it that voc ed worked in the past and it can't work in the future? Mm-hmm. I was talking to a politician not too long ago who told me, said, oh, voc ed is dead. We're in the modern age. Is you know, it's not a lot of hands on.
Yeah.
I said, then build a house. I says, yes, we have machines building cars. Mm-hmm. I said, but it better be somebody there to protect, to take care of that machine. Mm-hmm. You know, I says, we've gone away from real logical thinking as far as people are concerned, and that's because, and I really and truly believe this. People have stopped being involved, and the reason, but you know, which came first, the chicken or the egg? Did the people stop being involved, or did their lives become so difficult that they don't have time to spend doing things that don't generate funds for them to live? And so, that's what I think, is that politicians and our elected officials have figured it out that, hey, we've got it down to where it's only 22-30% of the American people going to vote. And now all we have to do is figure out how to get the majority of that, if I'm a D, or the majority if I'm a R. Because the I and those other groups are going to get a smidgen. They're not going to get the majority. And so we are the dominant group. And so someone came up with the idea, well, poor people, let's make life hard enough for them that they, you know, voting is they're not going to waste their time because they don't see no outcome. And so that's where we are today. Now, what we need to do is get our kids involved in education, because I don't care what anyone say, education is still the key. And so to walk in and go, yo, what it is, you know, instead of, hi, how are you? You know, to pull your pants up. I mean, and I'm not talking about black people. I'm talking about all people, because I was in Bend, Oregon, and I didn't see one black kid over there, but I saw a number of kids with their pants down. Their pants was sagging so they couldn't walk across
white
the street.
Kids, white kids.
I'm talking about white kids. And so, you know, we have to get our kids to thinking, all of our kids to thinking about positive things rather than negative things. I remember when I tell my son all the time, and he gets sick of me talking about the old days when I used to watch Little Rider and Red Rider, and they would shoot somebody and he'd fall off his horse, but you didn't see any blood. Today you can't sell a movie if the blood's not there, you know. And so we're making our kids so hard until they are not interested in getting involved, and they're not lazy, but they think they deserve it, even though they haven't earned it.
You know, you made another one point I want to pull out, one of your pieces you pulled out, the education piece aspect of it. And as you know, here in the Portland metropolitan area, we got the highest failure rate, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's this big push for GED.
Yeah,
you know, and I know there's a difference between a GED and a regular diploma, because the regular diploma piece, you're socializing, you know, you're working, you're doing with people, you're dealing, you're not just playing a little quickie test that you can go around the corner and learn how to pass it.
Right.
You got me? And in all due respect, it doesn't have the same value to an employer. A GED doesn't have the same value as a diploma.
Right.
So how do you break that cycle with these folks?
I really believe
for this area.
Right. I believe it's, you know, everyone has become hardened to the point that it's not my kid. And when you and I were growing up, if we ditched school and Mr. Jones saw us.
Yeah, that's the village, remember?
That's it.
That we started talking about the village. It takes a village to raise a child.
It takes a village.
But it ain't no village anymore.
Right. You know, if someone, you know, they told me, said, man, you shouldn't say anything to them kids, man. You don't know their parents. Well, I don't want to know their parents. I want the kids to know me and know that I have concern for them. You know, so don't do that. Mm-hmm. You know, here's why you shouldn't do that. I'm not going to talk down to them. Yeah. I'm going to talk to them. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing that we have done. Exactly. We've taken this and began to talk down to people mm-hmm. instead of talking with people. And our kids are not listening.
Well, you know, I think about the criminal justice system. It says that percentage-wise, there are more blacks, African-Americans in the criminal justice system yeah. than there are percentage-wise.
11.9. Someone gave me a number of 11.9 blacks are in the school anyway, district, are in yeah. the school district,
right.
but 39% are truant.
Right. See, and when you think about that particular system, now here you've got a captured market.
Mm-hmm.
They're right there, right?
Right.
Now, what an opportunity, if you will, because they're not educated. They don't have that diploma. Diploma. Mm-hmm. I'm not mm-hmm. talking about the GED aspect there. Here's an opportunity to put together another situation to get that social kind of gathering aspect of it in a classroom kind of an environment. It's a controlled environment. Why not?
I can tell you why not, because you don't make any money doing that. I mean, you want them to come back, you know, even though you say you don't. It's just, you know, I keep telling, I says the biggest misnomer in America is that we try to tell people we're one thing when we're actually doing another. Mm-hmm. And prison system is there for a reason. And the rule is somebody's got to go in order for those people to have a job.
Just economics.
That's it. It's strictly economic. This is a capitalist society, ladies and gentlemen. And if you think it's about socialism, then you're going to be lost and left behind.
So therefore, you better pick up that diploma.
You better pick up your diploma. You better stay in school, kids.
That's right.
And think about it. When your friend says, I'm going to steal this, or I'm going to take that, or I'm going to do this, and you know it's wrong, get away.
I got you.
Walk away.
I got you.
But, you know, for us, you and I.
Yeah.
We have a background in certain things around this city, around the state,
right.
And I know for a fact that you're interested in doing positive things for people, and so that's why I'm here with you.
That's what we've been talking about.
Yes, and one of the things is voc ed.
Yeah. Oh man.
We have to develop a system for people to get a job.
Yeah.
Not a job, because slaves had a job, but we're talking about a living wage job.
Yes, right.
You know, and we have to start talking to our congressmen and who make the laws that say that the companies in this country can take stuff offshore and bring it back free, tariff-free.
Mm-hmm.
We got to, hey, if you go take the job away, then you have to pay to bring the product back.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that simple.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've stopped being an industrial nation,
mm-hmm.
and we need to get back to that.
Mm-hmm.
We let little trivial things divide us.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm beginning to sound like my father, who was a Baptist preacher, and it's getting, you know.
Uh-oh.
But
you're getting ready to wear the cloth.
Yeah, that's it. You know, but
no,
it's time for us to stop the bickering.
Well, tell me this. Do you think culture has value? I'm thinking about that. We're going to have a guest that's going to come and talk mm-hmm. to us about what are they doing up in Texas, in the state of Texas, as relate to Juneteenth. You know, Juneteenth
mm-hmm.
has always been there. And, you know, we've done some things with Juneteenth. And we've taken it out of the just so-called just playing dominoes and drinking red soda pop into talking what that history was all about.
Mm-hmm.
And because from an inclusionary standpoint, Black folks fought for the stars and stripes for this country, but it's not been recognized. Right? You know what I'm saying? And so Juneteenth has always been there, but we haven't actually spent that time to make sure we take the having the pop and whatever into quote educating the majority community
mm-hmm.
as to what that meant, if you will, as far as inclusion. Fair?
Well, see, yes. I mean, you know, for me, Juneteenth means that the message didn't get to us when slavery was when slavery was abolished. The message didn't get to a lot of us who are black until real late.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, months after. And so, to me, that's my Juneteenth
mm-hmm.
because that's when we found out.
Mm-hmm. And why that was so.
Right.
I mean, yeah.
And
yeah.
so, we need to know our history.
Right.
You know, I always talk to my nephews and my sons and daughters, and I ask them. I says, "Have you ever looked at the coins?" You ever wonder why Lincoln faced a different direction than all the rest?
President Lincoln, former Republican.
Why is he faced in a different direction than everybody else on one of those coins? They turned their back on him because he freed the slaves.
Wow.
You know, I mean, it's just little things like that. I mean, we would never figure it out, you know, for just looking at it, because we're spending the money. We're not watching who's, how the faces are
turning. But in all these years, it took D's and R's to do that same thing.
Yes.
It wasn't just one side.
Right. I mean, there's some things that Republicans did that Democrats would have never gotten through.
Right.
And there's some things that Democrats have done.
Right.
You know, I mean, I stayed up at 2 o'clock in the morning watching TV, and I saw the black congressional honoring Reverend Jesse Jackson, mm-hmm. you know, when President Obama was first elected.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I remember Jesse saying after he received his award, "Thank you, but remember, the fight is not over."
Mm-hmm.
You know?
You're right.
And so, but I'm a real believer. You're a Lincoln. I'm a Philip Randolph.
Okay.
And he said...
Now, you know he was a Republican.
Oh, yes. And he said, power is never given, it's extracted.
But like I say, he was part of that culture that I'm saying.
Right.
You know, and that's why I maintain that, you know, it's really not R's and D's, you know.
No.
It's really about America, you know what I'm saying?
He was a fighter for the people.
He was, very much so.
And it wasn't a person, it was the people.
The people, you're right. Yeah. Look, I got this gentleman, Cecil Collier. He's going to be on the line with us, ladies and gentlemen, and he's from Texas, and the whole idea is that Cecil's going to come on and just chat with us a little bit about what's happening in Texas and how do they celebrate Juneteenth, and what are some of the activities that we might be able to replicate with our upcoming Juneteenth here in the state of Oregon, for that matter.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, it's in Portland. Say, so is Cecil on yet? Is Cecil on? You have him on?
I am here. This is Cecil Collier.
Hi, Cecil. How you doing?
Hey, my brother. How are you doing today?
Good, good. How's that weather down there in Texas? Is it snowing yet?
It's like June. It's getting ready to come. It's not even June yet.
All right. Well, hey, Cecil. I got Bob Williams here with me. The folks are listening to you via the Voters Digest here now. And we got upcoming Juneteenth, and I thought it would be refreshing to kind of give them a sense of what happens in Texas as it relates to Juneteenth. Can you share with us?
Well, my brother Broussard there, and the other brother, Bob.
Yeah, Bob Williams, yes.
Yeah.
If I could, I would like to start from the beginning so people can get the concept of, you know, just what Juneteenth means, you know, to some of us, especially here in Texas. And how they were kind of spread across the nation now.
Okay.
Juneteenth, you know, as we had it, you know, we're so hooked in this information society now where you can get things instantaneously by the push of a button. But unfortunately, our forefathers and our, you know, our ancestors before then, they had to kind of wait on information to get to them. And usually that the aid of someone else that didn't look like us. And the word for Juneteenth, or the emancipation of the people in Texas and beyond on those borders going west, the word didn't get out until about almost 2 years later. The Emancipation Proclamation came in 1863, and then I think it was, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was General Gordon Granger,
right.
His name is,
right.
Down in Galveston. He actually announced that, you know, the Texas slaves could be freed through that proclamation or emancipation proclamation.
Right.
And once they got that order, that kind of kicked out and spurred the celebration for June the 19th, or Juneteenth as we know it, pretty much today. As far as being the catalyst of the celebration.
Mm-hmm.
Since then, it kind of spread from Galveston to all points of Texas and throughout the Southwest. And now it's looking like, you know, since we're kind of mobile everywhere, Juneteenth just happened everywhere. It really gives us another reason to, you know, to celebrate this culture, man, of trying to figure out what it is about being black in America.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and we're short, since we're so short on celebrations, we can never have enough days to celebrate. So, give me Juneteenth, the 20th, everything else is going on. But I'm thankful for this day to be able to look for that. But how we're using it in Texas nowadays, especially in the area that I'm in, I'm from the Dallas-Fort Worth Denton area, as I call it, the DFWD, we have used Juneteenth as a catalyst for a teaching point.
Mm.
Because there have been so many things that we have, you know, been able to discover and learn about ourselves that we use this day where we've got everybody's attention to kind of use it as a tool just to teach.
Okay.
And so we use it, we usually spearhead a lot of our literacy programs and outreach programs around that time for that particular week.
Okay.
So, you know, that's
the gist of it all, basically?
That's one of the things that we do with it.
Okay. I take it then that it's also sort of an educational kind of a situation in terms of what happened during that particular time and the participation of African Americans in the Civil War, things of that nature. You guys get involved in those kinds of things?
Yes, we do. We have a faction of a series of parades and educational forums, speakers. You know, our political and community leaders of the day that actually come in and share. We have, you know, some of the, what I call the best teachers in our neighborhoods are some of those, you know, older seasoned gentlemen and ladies that have gone through some things and can remember things that happened even, you know, during this time period, those stories that were handed on to them.
Okay.
We use that as a way to actually share and, you know, and share with our youth and kind of inspire them on things that are going on now and push them to actually, you know, put their niche in what Juneteenth means to them today.
Mm-hmm. What about like for instance, the leadership, if you will, the leadership in Texas, you know, like the governor and those kind of folks who have been run for office, do they participate in the some of the activities?
Well, I'm going to put it like this. At first, Juneteenth, starting out from the stories that were passed down to me, the celebrations were well attended by our people and other people of color. But it's like, you know, the powers that be kind of got away from it because they use it as a day of saying, well, you know, let these folks have their day, you know, they're barbecuing, drinking red Kool-Aid and whatever else the deal may be. And, you know, just to kind of give them a day to actually, you know, just to celebrate them. And so they really didn't get off into it at first because they didn't understand what that day really meant to us. But as it started coming along, we started celebrating, we started getting more political leaders in the, you know, in the fiber of government on every level.
Right. Right.
We saw the importance of them actually being able to celebrate. So now you have cities that are, you know, they dedicate, some of them dedicate the whole week, some of them dedicate, you know, the week, you know, a series of weekend events, whatever. But I could, you know, it's picked up and spread on as things are caught across, you know, it's caught on and it went across the nation.
Okay.
And a lot of times things that happen outside the nation or outside the city and the state corridors of Texas, that is, really, really catapult a lot of things that happen, you know, within Texas. It's one of those things where, you know, I think I've spoken a couple of times to you, my brother Richard and Private, you know, our prophet's not, he's not, you know, welcome with, you know, inside his own home on something.
Uh-huh.
So we have to go do some things outside of Texas, outside the city of Dallas, Fort Worth, and Denton to actually bring some attention back to Juneteenth. And once they call home, you know, people don't like being shamed in their own neighborhood, so to speak.
Okay.
But now the cities have stepped up to the plate. They've allocated a little time, you know, it's like a start is good. We can always be more. But that's where we're at right now, and I see things going further from there.
Okay.
But yes, there are political leaders involved.
Okay. Well, Cecil, thank you very much for that input, and I'm sure you guys are going to have a very successful event this time around as far as Juneteenth, and we wish you all of the whatever, you know, and support that we can give. Hopefully we'll still keep a close watch of what you guys do and vice versa here. We're going to be doing something here locally, and we'll stay in touch. Is that okay, Cecil?
Sounds real good to me. Brother, sorry before I go right quick. Real quick question. Now, I'm always intrigued on the Juneteenth phenomenon happening in Portland up there. How long have you guys been celebrating?
Well, we've been, actually, Ms. Clara People was the one, and Mrs. Green were the one that's been doing this thing for a number of years. I've been involved in it for the last 7 years or so. And so it's been really a part of the community.
Right.
It really has been a part of the community. And we've got elected leadership and the like that have been involved in the process. And it's been well received. Maybe we don't get the numbers like we would like to get, but I think it's about 15 years or better. In fact, when the shipbuilding thing, I think that's when Mrs. Green,
it's very refreshing to hear that. I'm gonna pass the word on, let them know we got brothers and sisters out on the outskirts, man, that are celebrating this year as well.
Appreciate
and, man,
that.
Man, we'd love to be a part of your equation on what you're trying to do. But any help, anything we can do to help, just let us know.
And vice versa, the same thing here. Okay.
Thank you, my brother.
Cesar, thank you very much, and God bless.
Thank you.
It's okay. Thank you. Well, Bob, we got about a minute and a half. I thought that would be a good note to because it is an event that's going to be coming up in June, about the 20th of June, an aspect of it, and we really want people to get out and participate because it's very important that if you don't know where you came from, how can you go forward? You know what I'm saying? And it's very important. There was a very important time in our history of this country. And it's not just about Kool-Aid, you know what I'm saying? It's about the history of this country, and it should be taught in its entirety, in exclusivity.
And we who are black, we need to know what our history is and not let someone else tell us what it is. But research, find out, talk to your elders.
Right.
You know, we old guys, we do remember some things, and I remember back in the day when my grandfather and all was around, my great-grandfather, we used to sit and talk to each other.
Right.
I mean, it wasn't boring.
Right,
Now they got the hula hoop and the Cheerio, whatever. The kids don't want to sit and listen.
Right.
But we have to be the ones that go forth and get them to listen.
Well, thank you very much, Bob. Look like we've come to this point, and hopefully we're going to probably have Frederick Douglass. We're going to talk about that.
Okay.
We're going to be talking about that, and we're going to try to see if we can get a little bit more enthusiasm in this particular Juneteenth. So look forward to, in the upcoming shows, that we're going to be talking a little bit about that and more about that. Again, thank you very much for being a part of the show today. I'd like to tell Fred and also Bob, thank you very much. Again, we're getting to the general election, and I tell you, we're going to be at the table, so we're going to have some. We have to get some coffee now.
Yeah, we got to show up.
Okay.
Yeah, that's good. We have to show up,
folks. Thank you very much. We'll see you next week. Have a good one. Enjoy the Memorial Day. Looking forward to seeing you next week.